Welcome back, class 10. In your history class today, we will start off with chapter 3, Objectives and Methods of Struggle of Early Nationalists. Now, you should understand the history of Indian National Congress is a story of the rise and growth of vigorous national movement. Basically, India's struggle for freedom has major phases. Phases means paths. Number one, era of the early nationalists or the moderates, which started in 1885, ended in 1905. An era of assertive, which started in 1905, ended in 1919. And the Gandhian era from 1919 to 1939. And the final phase, from 1940 to 1947. So, in this chapter, we will study about the first phase, that means the era of the early nationalism. Remember, from 1885 to 1905, the era was there. Now, before starting, let us understand that when Congress was formed, in the initial stages, Congress was dominated by early nationalists. Naming some of the early nationalists, some of them were W.C. Banerjee, Rajbihari Bose, Surendranath Banerjee, R.C. Datta, Dadabhai Naurji, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, Ranade. They were, remember the names. Now, let us start on to understand what do you mean by early nationalists. The Congress in its infancy was dominated by men with moderate views. Moderate views means soft views, not aggressive views. There are three characteristics that distinguish them from other nationalists. They were the first nationalists. They were known as the moderate nationalists. First, what characteristics did the moderate nationalists have? Early nationalists and moderate nationalists, they are the same. Early nationalists were also known as moderate nationalists. Moderate means they were soft. They did not assert themselves. What were their characteristics? Number one, they had unlimited faith in British sense of justice. Now, this is a very peculiar thing. Basically, early nationalists were educated people. They thought of British connection with India as something which should continue for a larger good of England and in India both. What did they think? They thought that British were educated people and the early nationalists had unlimited, undying faith for them. The early nationalists thought that if we make the Britishers understand and if we make them aware of our difficulties, they will understand and they will listen to us, which they didn't, obviously. Number two, they, means the early nationalists, asked for constitutional and other reforms within the framework of British rule. The early nationalists wanted reforms, obviously, but they wanted the reforms within the constitutional framework of British rule. British rule will be there. But within that rule, within that framework, some changes will be there. They did not want complete freedom. Okay, try to understand. They did not want complete freedom. Number three, their methods of struggle was quite moderate. Moderate means not aggressive, cultured, soft, this type. They carried their agitation. Agitation means revolution, struggle, through petitions and resolutions. Resolution means promises made to the party, and petition means a writing regarding the demands which were signed by people. Mass petition. What did they do? They prayed to the government. They gave petition to the government. They were soft. They were moderate. They were cultured. They did not agitate in a very aggressive way. So these were the characteristics of moderate or the early nationalists. Clear? Good. Now, what were the objects of the early nationalists? The objects or principal demands, objects of the nationalists, early nationalists mean, what were their demands? Their demands could be divided into basically four heads. Number one, constitutional reforms, administrative reforms, economic reforms, and safeguarding of civil liberties. Okay, now going on to constitutional reforms. Number one, they, whenever I say they, you should understand that I'm talking about the early nationalists. They asked for the abolition of India Council, number one. Number two, the Congress at its very first session asked for expansion of Legislative Council. They required all legislative measures and financial questions, including budgets, to be submitted to this council. They wanted that Legislative Council should be expanded and all financial questions, budgets should be submitted to these councils. Number three, early in the 20th century, Congress leaders insisted on colonial form of national government. What does it mean? The system of administration to be found in Canada and Australia. Self-administration will be there, but within the framework of the British Raj. These were the three constitutional reforms they wanted. Number two, administrative reforms. The Congress urged means requested, upon the government. What administrative reforms? Number one, wider employment of Indians in higher services, number one. Number two, holding of simultaneous examinations in both England and India for the recruitment in the Indian Civil Service, ICS examination, simultaneously. At the same time, it will be held in England and in India. Number three, adequate representation of Indians in the Executive Council of Viceroy and those of the governors. Number four, complete separation of executive from the judiciary. And number five, an increase in the powers of local municipal bodies and reducing official controls over them. So these were the five administrative reforms they wanted. You should remember, you should memorize them, and you should, it is very easy to memorize, you know. If you understand what the early nationalists wanted from the Britishers, you will understand and you will memorize point by point. So first, we discussed three constitutional reforms. Then we discussed five administrative reforms. Now, we will discuss five economic reforms. The early Congress leaders demanded reduction of land revenue and protection of peasants against the unjust demands of the zamindars, protection of peasants. Number two, giving cheap loan or credit to the peasants through agricultural banks. Number three, total abolition of salt tax and duty on sugar. Number four, industrial growth through trade protection, that means taxing on the imported goods coming from outside, taxing on them. And they also suggested that government should take loans, should make loans for the growth of iron, coal, sugar, paper industries. And lastly, they suggested reduction in expenditures of army so that the surplus money which they will have could be saved and spent to social services, health and education. Last point was safeguarding the civil liberties. What are the civil liberties? Civil liberties means liberties given to the civilians. Number one, early congressmen opposed tooth and nail suppression of freedom of speech and expression. They said that if the Britishers suppressed the freedom of speech, if they suppressed the freedom of expression, if they suppressed free press, what they will do? They will encourage the revolution in an indirect way. If the more you suppress, more there will be revolution, and there will be an underground revolution. On the top, there will not be any revolution. But more you suppress the Indians, more you take the freedoms from them, the more rebellious they will become. That is what they wanted. They wanted not to suppress. They requested the Britishers, requested, obviously, not to suppress any form of civil liberties. Now, beliefs and methods of struggle of early nationalists. What were their beliefs? What did they believed in? The early nationalists had unlimited faith in the British sense of justice and fair play. They had that belief in them. And they, Dadabhai Nauroji was honest enough to recognize the benefits which English rule has conferred on Indians, especially the English language, modern means of communication and transport. They always looked at the brighter side of the British rule, and they had a very undying faith on their justice, undying faith in the British sense of fair play. That was their belief. They thought that if we approach Britishers in a very civilized way, in a very moderate way, non-assertive way, they will understand. Whether they understood or not, the whole the Indian history, you know. What were their methods of struggle? They did not take banners and jhandas and went yelling and howling on the road. They were not that type. The early nationalists did not believe in agitation, disturbance, or unconstitutional means which are unconstitutional, okay, illegal. They carried their agitations through petitions, giving in writing and signing it to the government officials, resolution. In a meeting, they conducted meeting, and in the meeting, resolution is passed. That means what is the resolution? In a meeting, what steps you will take in future is a resolution. Resolution means we are resolving that in future we will take such steps. Whether those steps will be taken or not, that's a different thing. Meetings in town, very soft meetings, mild meetings, very cultured meetings. Cities and countrysides, distribution of leaflets and pamphlets. You take this, people will read, they will understand and throw it away. Preparing memorandum for government committees. Delegations leading to politicians in England. These memorandums or petitions were formally addressed to the government. Basically, these leaders believed that once the government was convinced of the genuine needs for reforms, their demands will be conceded, means listened, sooner or later, which they never listened. The early congressmen merely wanted to mitigate the evil of the British rule, not to terminate it. They did not want termination of the British rule. They want that the positivity of the British rule remains, and the Britishers, let them stay in our country, and they will stay in our country and they will listen to us also. Okay? Because it was the start of the Congress. You know what happens is when you start an organization, there is a specific way of functioning. If at the start that certain method fails, the next method comes. So now, while going through the history book, we might find this way or approach very funny, very unrealistic. But at that time, No one was there. They were the only people who started the national movement. They started the struggle. So that is why it is included in your history syllabus. That is all for today. We will meet again and we will further continue this chapter. Thank you.